For non-bikers, social tensions exist for various reasons. Sometimes it is a pure resentment of the recklessness of riders for breaking rules, whether that results in dangerous situations or not.
Get off the bike, you idiot! God damn you!
Furthermore, as much as biking is a mere form of transportation, it is just as much a culture, and with any culture comes some form of counterculture.
I ascribe a lot of the behavior to a theory that I think was originally promoted by Aaron Napperson, which is modal prejudice. So whatever transportation mode you're in, if you're in a car, then, you know, these pedestrians are all in your way, and they're not paying attention, and they're crossing in front of you, and can't they go faster? If you're in a bike, you know, same thing, but the cars are at fault. And then if you're walking, you know, the bikes are sort of flying through and you're mad at them, you're mad at the cars. So your bias is skewed toward whatever mode of transportation there is.
You know, people get stuck in their ways. They like the way things are. Or maybe they don't love the way things are, but they're just used to the way things are.
New Yorkers, you know, they like things the way that they get used to them, like most people.
It may seem strange that people would be opposed to the culture of biking. I'm not even talking about punk skater kids doing tricks, making noise, leaving trash, and loitering. I'm talking about people opposed to the idea that they would have to share the streets with a bicycle. These people actually exist all around New York, specifically in South Williamsburg and Brooklyn. The Hasidic Jews of the area, whose family moved there during and after World War II, have since claimed the streets as their own. Like so many other cultural pockets in the city, walking around the streets made one feel like they were in a totally different country. But unlike other neighborhoods, this group decided to govern the streets their own way, independent of any city laws. They enforced their own social codes, with their own police, the Shamrim. One thing that the Hasidim of South Williamsburg have collectively fought is the bike lane that was installed on Bedford Avenue as one of the proposed priority routes of the New York City Bicycle Master Plan of 1997. The eventual Bedford Ave bike lane helped improve a street already frequented by bicycles, and it became the backbone of Brooklyn's bicycle network. Anybody riding from Brooklyn to the Williamsburg Bridge would most logically use Bedford Avenue. However, the Hasidim of the community, most of whom regard biking as for children only, were very opposed to the bike lane, and other nearby lanes as well. The friction was only worsened by retaliating riders, some of whom even staged naked bike rides, simply as a gesture of their First Amendment rights. However, the First Amendment wasn't something the Hasidim of South Williamsburg took seriously. For them, this was their town, and they made the rules. Therefore, with some apparent timely political donations, the community maneuvered to have the lane removed in December of 2009, the first lane removal from the city's blossoming bike network. Bikers were outraged. Some even tried to paint it back, only to be apprehended by the Shamrim and later arrested by New York Police Department for vandalism. Various rallies, community discussions, and advocacy groups have tried to restore order on Bedford Avenue, but as of now, it looks like this is a lost cause. Not surprisingly, many people still bike on Bedford Avenue, as it is still the best route. It's just back to its old design for now, forcing bikers to fend for themselves. However, citywide, the culture of biking is still growing.
You know, when a certain number of people are doing something like cycling on the streets in New York, it becomes not only perceived to be safer, but actually safer. It also becomes a trend. It becomes cool. And we know New York is very trend-driven. So when you see certain types of people out there cycling on a daily basis, that helps encourage other people to do it.
People get more used to biking and bike lanes, and they'll know how they work.
Like an old machine. Turn as fast as it used to. Sometimes I take a ride and find out that it's wrong. Don't know the difference in a way, 'cause it ain't it for now and then. It'll always help me find my way again.
What is the ultimate goal of street design improvements? Will we ever be done? What are the limits?
I don't think street improvements are really ever finished. And cities in general are never finished, quote unquote. They are perpetually in motion. They're always changing, always adapting.
Maybe even though the thought is on my mind, don't mean that I won't see it soon. Cause it ain't it for now and then. It'll always help me find my way again. So won't you run?
The city is ever changing, so I don't think you should ever think of yourself as being done with anything. I also believe, especially when you design public spaces, that they should be designed in a flexible way so they can accommodate and adapt to different uses. You can, you know, do your best to try to accommodate, you know, existing behavior and existing trends, but then you need to go back and change things. I mean, we are designing out a, like, 1950s highway mentality for our streets, and designing in a 21st century mentality for our streets. But that could change, and things could continue to go further in the direction they're going. They could go back. We may need to balance some neighborhoods differently than others. So I don't think we should ever think of ourselves as being done.